Is all company here?
You are best to call them individually, man by man, according to the script.
Here's a scroll with every man's name copied through all the bathrooms in the planar alien before the Duke and Duchess on his wedding day at night.
First, Peterquitz, say what the play treats on, and then read the name of the actors.
Mary, in his most lamentable comedy and most cruel death, of Pyramus in Thisbe.
A very good piece of work, I assure you, and the Mary. Now, good Peterquitz, call forth your actors by the scroll. Masters, spread yourselves.
Answers, I call you. Nick Bottom the Weaver.
Ready! Name what part I am for, and proceed.
You, Nick Bottom, are set down for Pyramus.
What is Pyramus? A lover or a tyrant?
A lover that kills himself. Most gallant for love.
That love will ask some tears in the true performing of it. If I do it, let the audience look to their eyes. I will move storms. Now name the rest of the players.
Francis Flute, the bellows mender.
Here, Peter Quince.
Flute, you must take Thisbe on you.
And what is Thisbe? A wandering knight?
A lady Pyramus must love.
Nay, Faith, let me not play a woman, from a beard coming.
That is all one. We shall play no mask and speak as little as you wish.
If I may hide my face, let me play Thisbe too. I will speak in a monstrous little voice. Fizzin, fizzin!
Oh, Pyramus, my lover dear, thy Thisbe dear and lady dear.
No. You must play Pyramus and Flute, you Thisbe.
Well, proceed.
Tom Snout the Tinker.
Here, Peterquitz.
Tom Snout, you must play Thisbe's mother, myself Pyramus's father, and Slug the Joiner, you the lion's part.
Have you the lion's part written? Pray you, if it be, give it to me, for I am slow of study.
You may do it extempore, first nothing but roaring.
Let me play the lion too. I will roar so that it will do any man's heart. Good to hear me.
And you should do it too terribly, for we wouldn't want to frighten the Duchess and the ladies. They wouldn't have us home.
I will roar as gently as any dove. I will roar as any nightingale.
You play no part but Pyramus.
Well, I will undertake it.
Masters, hear your parts. I entreat you, desire you, and request you to come in by tomorrow night and meet me a mile without town. There we shall rehearse. For if we meet in the city, we will be dog company and our devices will be known. In the meantime, I will draw a will of property such as our play wants. I pray you, fail me not.
We will meet, and there we will rehearse most obscenely and courageously. Take pains, be perfect, adieu!
At the Duke's Oak we meet.
Intruding knavish bride called Robin Goodfellow.
Thou speakest aright. I am that very wanderer of the night. I just to Oberon and make him smile. But Room Fairy, here comes Oberon.
Ill met by moonlight, proud Titania.
What, jealous Oberon? Fairy, get hence. I first warned his bed and company.
Tarry, rash wanton, am I not thy lord?
Then I must be thy lady.
Why should Titania cross her Oberon? I do but beg a little changeling boy to be my henchman.
Set your heart at rest. The fairyland buys not this child of me. His mother was a votress of my order in the spiced Indian air by night. Full often hath she gossiped by my side and sat with me on Neptune's yellow sands. She, being mortal of that boy, did die. And for her sake do I rear up her boy. And for her sake, I will not part with him.
Give me that boy!
Not for thy fairy kingdom. Fairies, away.
Well, go thy way, thou shalt not from this grove. Till I torment thee for this injury, my gentle pup, come hither. Fetch me the flower, the herb I showed thee once. The juice of it on sleeping eyelids lay will make or man or woman madly dote upon which thy next creature sees. Fetch me this herb.
I'll put a girdle round about the earth in 40 minutes.
And having once this juice, I'll watch Titania when she is asleep, and drop the liquor of it on her eyes. The next thing she waking looks upon, be it lion, bear, wolf, or bull, on meddling monkey or busy ape, she shall pursue it with her soul of love. In air I can take this charm off as I can with another herb. I will make her render her page up to me, but who comes? I'm invisible, and I will overhear their conference.
I love thee not, therefore pursue me not. Where is Lysander and fair Hermia? The one I'll slay, and the other slayeth me. Thou told me you were stolen unto this wood.
You draw me, you hard-hearted adamant!
Do I entice you? Do I speak you fair? Or rather, do I not in plainest truth tell you I cannot nor I do not love you?
And even for that, I do love you the more. I'm your spaniel, spurn me, strike me, neglect me, lose me, only give me leave unworthy as I am to follow you.
Tempt not too much the hatred of my spirit, for I'm sick when I do look upon thee.
And I'm sick when I look not on you.
You do impeach your modesty too much to leave the city and commit yourself to the hands of one that loves you not.
Your virtue is my privilege!
Let me go! Or if thou follow me, do not believe, and I shall do thee mischief in the wood.
Follow thee and make a heaven of hell to die upon the hand I love so well!
Fare thee well, nymph, ere he do leave this grove. Thou shalt fly him and shalt pursue thy love. Hast thou flower there? Welcome, wanderer.
Aye, there it is.
I pray thee, give it me. I know a bank where the wild thyme blows, where the ox lips and nodding violets grow, quite over canopied with luscious woodbine, with sweet musk roses and with elegant thyme. There lies Titania sometime in the night, lulled with flowers and dances the light. And there the snake throws her enamel skin, weed wide enough to wrap a fairy in. And having once this juice, I'll streak her eyes, make her full of hateful fantasies. Take thou some of it, seek through this grove. A sweet Athenian lady is in love with a disdainful youth. Anoint his eyes, and the next thing he may espy may be the lady. Thou shalt know the man by the Athenian garments he hath on, and affect it with some care, that he may prove more fond of her than she her love, and meet me ere the first cock crow.
Fear not, my lord, your servant shall do so.
Come, now a roundel and a fairy song. Sing me asleep and let me rest.
Spot snakes with double tongue, thorny hedgehogs do not sting.
Mute and blind worms do no wrong. Down them near our fairy queen.
Night in melody, singing our sweet lullaby. La 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 la. Never harm nor spell nor char, come our lovely lady nigh. So good night with lullaby, la 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 la.
Weaving spiders, come not here, hence you long-legged spinner's head.
Beetles black approach not near, warm nor snail do not offend.
Nightingale with melody, singing our sweet lullaby. La 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 la. Never harm no spell nor shore, come our lovely lady nigh. So good night with lullaby, la 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 la.
Hence, away!
Now all is well.
One aloof than sentinel.
Thank you.
what thou seest when thou so swayest. Do it for thy true love, take love and languish for his sake, be it lynx, cat, bear, or boar upon bristled hair. In thine eyes thou shalt appear, when thou wakest, it is thy dear, wake with some vile thing is here.
Fair love, you faint with wandering in the wood, and to speak truth, I have forgot our way. We'll rest us here if you think it good, and tarry for the comfort of day.
Be it so, Lysander, find you out of bed, for I upon this bank will rest my head.
One turf shall serve as pillow for us both, one heart, one bed, two bosoms in one trough.
Nay, my good Lysander, for my sake, my dear, lie further off yet, do not lie so near.
Oh, take the sense, sweet of my innocence.
Gentle friend, for love and courtesy, lie further off in human modesty. Such separation as may well be said becomes a virtuous bachelor and a maid. So far be distant, and good night, sweet friend. Thy love ne'er alter till thy sweet life end.
Amen. Amen to that fair prayer, say I, and then end life when I am loyalty. Here is my bed. Sleep give thee all his rest.
Who is here? Athens he doth wear. This is he, my master said. Despise the Athenian maid. And hear the maiden sleeping sound on the dank and dirty ground. Pretty soul, she durst not lie. Near this lack love, this killed courtesy. Churl, upon thy eyes, I throw all the power this charm doth owe. When thou wakest, let love forbid sleep his seat on her eyelid. So awake when I am gone, for I must now to Oberon. Stay those thou and kill me, sweet Demetrius!
I charge thee hence and do not haunt me. Thus I alone will go.
But who is here? Lysander on the ground? Dead or asleep? I see no blood, no wound. Lysander, if you live, good sir, awake.
And run through fire will I for thy sweet sake, oh. Transparent Helena, nature shows art that through thy bosom makes me see thy heart. Oh, where is Demetrius? Oh, how fit a word is that vile name to perish on my sword?
Do not say so, Lysander, say not so. Hermia still loves you, then be content.
Content with Hermia? No, I do repent the tedious minutes I with her have spent. Not Hermia, but Helena I love. Oh, who would not change a raven for a dove?
Wherefore was I to this keen mockery born? When at your hand did I deserve this scorn? Oh, that a lady of one man is used, should of another therefore be abused!
She sees not Hermia. Hermia, sleep thou there, and never mayest thou come Lysander near. For as a serpent of the sweetest things, the deepest loathing to the stomach brings, oh, to honor Helena and to be her knight!
Help me, Lysander, help me! Do thy best about this crawling serpent from my breast! Cry me for pity, what a dream was here! Lysander, look how I do quake with fear! Methought a serpent eat my heart away, and you sat smiling at his cruel prey. Lysander? Lysander, Lord? But gone? No sound nor word? Out of hearing? Either death or you will find immediately.
Place for rehearsal. We will do it as we will do it for the Duke.
Teacher Quince!
What sayest thou, Bully Bottom?
There are things in this comedy of Pyramus and Thisbe that will never please. First, Pyramus must draw a sword to kill himself, which the ladies cannot abide. How answer you that?
By our ladies, a peerless fear.
I believe we must leave killing out when all is done.
Not a whit! I have a device to make all well. Write me a prologue. And let the prologue seem to say that we will do no harm with our swords, and that Pyramus is not killed indeed. And, for the more better assurance, tell them that I, Pyramus, am not Pyramus, but Bottom the Weaver. This will put them out of fear.
Will not thy ladies be afeard of the lion?
I fear it, I promise you.
Then another prologue must tell, he is not a lion.
Nay, you must name his name, and half his face must be seen through the lion's neck, and he himself must speak, saying thus, ladies, or fair ladies, I would wish you, or I would request you, or I would entreat you, not to fear, not to tremble. I'm a man as other men are.
That may be, but there are still two hard things. That is to bring moonlight into the chamber. For we all know, Kirmes and Thisbe meet by moonlight.
Doth the moon shine that night we play our play?
Calendar! Calendar! Look in the almanac! Find out moonshine! Find out moonshine!
It doth shine that night.
Why then? May we leave a casement of the great chamber window, where we play, open, so that the moonshine may shine in at that casement.
Aye, or else one must come in with a lantern and a bushel of thorns that says he comes to represent or disfigure the man of moonshine.
Then there is another thing. We must have a wall in the chamber, for Pyramus and Thisbe, says the story, did talk through the cheek of a wall.
You can never bring in a wall, what say you, Bottom?
Some man or other must present wall. Let him hold his fingers thus, and through that cranny shall Pyramus and Thisbe whisper.
Well, it shall be so. Come, every mother's son, sit down where here's your part. Pyramus, you begin. Once you've spoken your speech, enter into that break, and everyone according to his cue.
What hempen homespuns have we swaggering here? So near the cradle of the fairy queen? What? A play torn? I'll be an auditor, an actor too, perhaps, if I see cause.
Speak, Pyramus. Thisbe, stand for.
Thisbe, the flowers of odious savor sweet.
Odors. Odors.
Odors, savor sweet. So hath thy breath, my dearest Thisbe dear. But hark, a voice. Stay thou but here a while, and by to thee I will appear.
Must I speak now?
Aye, marry you must, for you must understand. He goes with the sea noise he heard, and it is to come again.
Most radiant Pyramus, most lily-white of hue, of color like the red rose on triumphant briar, I'll meet thee, Pyramus, at Ninny's tomb.
Ninny's tomb, man! Why, you must not speak that yet. You speak your whole part once, cues and all. Pyramus enters. Your cue has passed.
If I were fair, Thisbe, I were only thine.
O monstrous, O strange, run, masters, play, masters, help!
Why do they run? This is neighbor of them to make me afeard. I will walk up and down here and will sing that they know I am not afraid. The woozlecock so black of hue, with orange and tawny bill, the thrustle with his note so true, the wren with little quill.
What angel wakes me from my flowery bed?
The finch, the sparrow, and the lark, the plain song cuckoo gray, whose note for me a man doth mark and dares not answer nay.
I pray thee, gentle mortal, sing again. My ear is much enamored of thy note, so is my eye enthralled to thy shape, and thy fair virtue's force perforce doth move me on the first view to sing, to swear I love thee.
Methinks, mistress, you should have little reason for that. And yet, to say the truth, reason and love keep little company nowadays.
Thou art as wise as thou art beautiful.
Not so neither.
Oh, I do love thee, therefore go with me, and I will send thee fairies to attend on thee, and they shall fetch you jewels from the deep, and sing while on pressed flowers doth sleep. and thou will purge thy mortal grossness so. Thou shalt like an airy spirit go. Peace blossom, cobweb, moth, mustard seed.
Ready?
And I.
Where shall we go?
Be kind and courteous to this gentleman, hop in his walks and gamble in his eyes. Feed him with apricots, blackberries, and mulberries. The honey bags steal from the bumblebees. Nod to him, elves, and do him courtesies.
Hail, mortal.
Hail.
Come, wait upon him, then lead him to my bower.
Titania be awakened. Then what next came to her eyes? She must dote on in extremity. Here comes my messenger. How now, mad spirit?
My mistress with a monster is in love. Near to her close and consecrated bower, she was in her dull and sleeping hour. A crew of pages, rude mechanicals that work for bread upon Athenian stalls, were met to rehearse a play intended for great Theseus' nuptial day. I led them on in this distracted fear, and left sweet Pyramus translated there. When in that moment, so it came to pass, Titania waked and straightway loved an ass.
This works out better than I could advise, but hast thou yet latched the Athenian eyes as I did bid thee do?
I took him sleeping, that is finished too, and the Athenian woman by his side, that when he waked, of force she must be eyed.
Stand close, this is the same Athenian.
This is the woman, but not this the man.
Oh, why rebuke you him that loves you so? They press so bitter on your bitter foe.
Nigh, but shy, but I should use thee worse, for thou, I fear, has given me cause to curse. If thou hast slain Lysander in his sleep, bring your shoes and blood, plunge in the deep and kill me too.
I'm not guilty of Lysander's blood, nor is he dead for aught that I can tell.
I pray thee, tell me then that he is well.
And if I could, what should I get there for?
A privilege, never see me more. From my hated presence part I so, see me no more whether he be dead or no.
There's no following her in this fierce vein, thus here, therefore, for a while. I shall remain.
What hast thou done that hast mistaken quite, and they loved you on some true love sight? Go about the woods, swifter than the wind, and love thou find Helen of Athens, all fancy sick, and pale as here with sighs of love, the cause, the fresh blood dear. By some illusion, bring her here, and I'll charm his eyes against she go to hear.
I go, look how I go, swifter than an arrow from the Tartar bow.
Flower of this purple dye, hit with Cupid's archery. Sink, apple of his eye. When his love he doth espy, let her shine as glorious as the Venus of the sky. When thou wakest, if she is by, beg for her for me.
Captain of our fair band, Helena's here hand, and the youth, mistook by me, pleading for a lover's fee, shall we their fallen pageant see? Lord, what fools these mortals be!
Stand aside, the noise they make will cause Demetrius to awake.
Then go to at once, for one that must needs be sport alone, and these things do best please me that befall monstrously.
Why should you think that I should woo and scorn? Demetrius loves her, and he loves not you.
Helena, God is perfect divine, to what my love shall I compare thy night? Chrysalis muddy, oh how ripe and show those lips, those kissing cherries tempting grow. Let me kiss this princess, this seal of bliss.
Oh, spite, oh hell, I fear all bent to set against me for your merriment. If you were civil and new courtesy, you would not do me with this much injury. Do you not hate me, as I know you do, but you must joy in souls to mock me too? Oh, what derision, and not of noble sort, would so offend a virgin and extort a poor soul's patience, all to make you sport.
You are unkind, Demetrius. Be not so, for you love Hermia. This you know I know, and here with all goodwill, with all my heart. In Hermia's love I yield you up my part, and yours of Helena to me bequeath, whom I do love and shall do till my death.
Never did mockers waste more idle breath.
Lysander, keep thy Hermia, I will none. If e'er I loved, all the love is gone.
Helen, it is not so.
Look where thy love comes, yonder is thy dear.
Why kindly dost thou leave me so?
Why should he stay, whom love doth press to go?
What love could press Lysander from my side?
Why seekest thou me? Could not make thee know the hate I bear thee made me leave thee so.
You speak not as you think, it cannot be.
Lo, she is one of this confederacy! Now I perceive they have conjoined all three to fashion this false sport in spite of me.
Injurious Hermia, most ungrateful maid, have you conspired? Have you with these two contrived to bait me with this foul derision?
I am amazed at your passionate words. I scorn you not, though it seems you scorn me.
Have you not said lies, Sandra, as you scorn to praise my eyes and face? Send your other lover, Demetrius, to call me perfect, goddess, divine, rare, celestial, and nymph?
I understand not what you mean by this.
I do, Perserver. Counterfeit makes sad looks at me when I turn my back, wink at each other, hold the sweet jest up. This sport well carried soon shall be chronicled. If you have any pity, grace, or manners, you would not make me such an argument. Oh, but fare ye well. 'Tis partly my own fault, which death or absence soon shall remedy.
Stay gentle, fair Helena. Hear my excuse, my love, my life, my soul, fair Helena.
Oh, excellent.
Helen, I love thee. By my life I do. I swear by that which I will lose for thee, to prove him false, but since I love thee not.
I say I love you more than he can do.
If thou say so, withdraw and prove it too.
Why have you grown so rude? What changes this, sweet love?
Thy love? Out, tawny tartar, out! Out, low medicine, oh hated potion, hence! What, should I strike her? Kill her dead? Although I hate her, I'll not harm her so.
What greater harm can you do to me than hate? Hate me? What wrong me? What changes this, sweet love? Am I not Hermia? Are you not Lysander? I am as fair now as I was erewhile.
'Tis no jest that I do hate thee and love Helena.
Oh, mate! You juggler! You kicker blossom! You thief of love!
You counterfeit, you puppet, you!
Puppet? Why so? Because I'm so dwarfish and so low? How low am I, thou painted maypole? Speak! How low am I? Not yet so low that my nails cannot reach in thine eyes!
I pray you, though you mock me, gentlemen, let her not hurt me. I was never cursed. I have no gift at all in shrewishness.
Why get you gone? Who is it that hinders you?
Though she be little, she is fierce.
Little again? Nothing but low and little. Why must you let her flout me thus? Let me come to
get you gone, you dwarf, you minimus of hindering not grass made, you bead. Acorn!
Speak not of Helena. Take not her part, for if thou dost intend a little show of love to her, thou shalt abide it.
Now she holds me not. Now follow if thou darst to try who's right. What's thine or mine is most in Helena.
Nay, then I'll follow thee cheek by jowl.
You mistress, all this coil is long of you. Nay, go not back.
I will not trust you. I nor longer stay in your cursed company. Oh, your hands and mine are quicker for a frame. My legs are longer, though, to run away.
I am amazed and know not what to say.
This is thy negligence. Still thou hast mistaken Squadron's. Commandest thy knaveries willingly.
Believe me, King of Shadows, I mistook. Did you not tell me I should know the man by the Athenian garments he had on?
Thou seest these lovers seek a place to fight. Hide, therefore, Robin, overcast night, and crush the herb into Lysander's eye, whose liquor hath virtuous property, taking from all thence air with his might, and making his eyeballs roll with wanted sight. When they next awake, all this derision shall seem a dream and fruitless vision, and back to back until the lovers wed, with leave whose date till death shall never end. While eyes in this affair do the employ to my fairy queens and beg her Indian boy. Then I will charm I release from monster's view, and all things shall be peace.
My fairy lord, this must be done with haste, for night's swift dragon cuts the clouds full fast, and yonder shines Aurora's harbinger, at whose approach ghosts, wandering here and there, troop home to the churchyards.
But we are spirits of another sort. Haste, make no delay, we may effect business yet ere day.
Upon and down, up and down, I will lead them up and down. I am feared in field and town. Goblin, lead them up and down. Here comes one.
Where art thou, proud Demetrius? Speak thou now.
Here, villain, drawn and ready, where art thou?
I will be with thee straight.
Follow me then to plainer ground.
Lysander, speak again. Thou coward, thou runaway, art thou fled? Speak in some bush, where dost thou hide thy head?
Thou coward? Art thou bragging to the stars, telling the bushes that thou look'st for wars and wilt not come? Come, preparant, come, thou child. I'll whip thee with the rod. He is defiled that draws a sword on thee.
Yea, art thou here?
Follow my voice. We'll try no man to hear.
He goes before me and still dares me on.
I followed fast, but faster did he fly. That fallen am I in dark uneven way, and here will rest me. Come, thou gentle day, for if but once thou show me thy gray light, I'll find Demetrius and revenge this spite.
Ho, 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 coward, why comest thou not?
Where art thou now?
Come hither, I am here.
Nay, then thou mockest me. Thou shalt buy this deer.
If ever thy face by daylight see.
On the ground, sleep sound. I'll apply to your eye, gentle lover remedy. When thou wakest, thou takest true delight in the sight of thy former lady's eye, and the country proverb known that every man shall have his own, in your waking shall be shown. Jack shall love Jill, naught shall go ill. The man shall love his Marigan, and all shall be well.